Extinction is a fundamental part of life. While a certain background rate of extinction is normal and healthy, history tells us that there have been times when this rate skyrocketed. These moments are known as mass extinctions. In this second part of our series on Earth's extinction events, we'll explore the dramatic end of the Ordovician period and uncover whether the Silurian period was truly the picture of stability it's often believed to be. Don't worry if you missed the first part, this video stands on its own. But if you're curious, check out the playlist on my channel for a complete exploration of Earth's mass extinctions. You'll find a document with sources for images and research papers I used in the video description down below. In our last video, we delved into the chaotic finale of the Cambrian period and the dawn of the Ordovician. Today, we look closer at the Ordovician itself, which, like its predecessor, ended with a mass extinction. This pattern is not unusual, as we'll discover throughout the series. Scientists define the various eons, eras, periods, and more by noting significant shifts in the Earth's climate, geography, geology, and fauna and flora. These shifts are commonly accompanied by an extinction event. Let's take the Cambrian and Ordovician periods as examples. The Cambrian period is known for its remarkable burst in biodiversity, the Cambrian explosion. Here, many major groups of animals we recognize today first made their appearance. Think arthropods, brachiopods, and mollusks. Life was ocean-bound, and shallow seas created by the warm climate and high sea levels. Interestingly, high sea levels meant extensive areas of what is now land were submerged, forming vast shallow marine waters. This was a world dominated with trilobites and archaeocyathids, both of which are now extinct. Trilobites, marine arthropods with tough exoskeletons, left an extensive fossil record, although only 38 of the 20,000 known trilobite fossils preserve parts of their soft bodies. Archaeocyathids, the first reef-building sponges, had gone extinct by the end of the Cambrian period. This period concluded with a mass extinction, which we covered in detail in our previous video. Now, let's compare that to the Ordovician, which is the period that chronologically follows the Cambrian. Despite some similarities, the Ordovician had many unique traits. The Ordovician began with the Ordovician radiation event for another biodiversity boom, and ended in another mass extinction, something we'll dive into later in this video. Early in the Ordovician, the climate remained warm, but the latter part saw significant cooling and glaciation. Life was still confined to the oceans, but evolved in dramatically different directions. This period saw the emergence of corals and jawless fish, the earliest vertebrates. Dominant species include graptolites, conodonts, and brachiopods. Graptolites, filter-feeding organisms that form colonies, were diverse during the Ordovician, although only one genus remains alive today. Brachiopods, often mistaken for bivalves, surprisingly still thrive with over 120 genera today. Conodonts were vertebrates known primarily for their tooth-like fossils, but the very few impression fossils of them suggest that they had eel-like bodies. These did not survive the test of time, going extinct during the Triassic period. The contrasting climates and fauna of the Cambrian and Ordovician periods illustrate how Earth's history is marked by significant transitions. The Cambrian-Ordovician extinction event, a critical juncture, played a major role in shaping the fauna of the Ordovician. While not all periods conclude with such dramatic events, as the series will reveal, many do. Now, let's return to the dramatic finale of the Ordovician. This period ended with a significant event known as the Ordovician-Silurian Extinction Event, or the Late Ordovician Mass Extinction. Notably, this event is the first of the Big Five, the five most catastrophic mass extinctions in the Earth's history, initially proposed by Sepkoski and Raup in 1982. While some argue for additional events like the Capitanian or Holocene extinctions to be added to this list, the Big Five remain the most monumental losses of life recorded. The Ordovician-Silurian extinction event, which occurred roughly 445 million years ago, marked the end of the Ordovician period and continued into the early Silurian. It holds the title of the second largest extinction in Earth's history, based on the percentage of genera that went extinct. Here's a useful graph illustrating the percentage of marine genera that went extinct over time, with peaks representing mass extinctions. You'll notice that while this event may not have the second highest peak on this graph, it's set apart by a crucial factor. During the Ordovician, there was no known terrestrial life. Consequently, this peak represents a total biodiversity loss, unlike later extinctions, where land ecosystems also contributed to the total loss. So, just how devastating was the end Ordovician? While estimates vary, scientists generally agree that around 50 to 60% of genera and over 85% of all species went extinct. That kind of loss is almost unimaginable today. Picture a world where 85% of current species vanish overnight. While we might leave that kind of apocalyptic scenario to zombie movies, let's return to the Ordovician to understand what happened. The Ordovician-Silurian extinction event was actually two pulses of extinctions, each driven by opposing causes. The first pulse, LOMEI-1, occurred between the Cadian and Hernantian stages. During this time, the Earth experienced significant cooling, culminating in the Hernantian Glaciation, the only ice age believed to have caused a mass extinction of this scale. While the exact cause of this glaciation remains a mystery, several theories attempt to explain it. Let's start with carbon dioxide, or CO2. Throughout the Ordovician, CO2 levels were significantly high, around 8 to 20 times pre-industrial levels. High CO2 typically warms the Earth, which makes the onset of glaciation puzzling. However, it appears CO2 levels plummeted during the Hernantian stage. Why this happened remains unclear, but several hypotheses offer potential explanations. Let's start with the hypothesis that terrestrial flora experienced a major explosion in abundance. The first evidence of terrestrial plants appears in the Ordovician, albeit sparse. One theory suggests an explosion in plant life at this time, increasing photosynthesis exponentially and thus decreasing atmospheric CO2. However, there is no fossil evidence to support this. The next suggestion is that organic carbon was buried by marine sediments. This is a process that forms part of the carbon cycle. While the organic carbon is trapped in the Earth, it will not be released as part of the carbon cycle, effectively removing CO2 from the atmosphere. We are reaping the benefits of this process today, as fossil fuels like coal or oil originated as organic carbon buried in sediments over hundreds of millions of years. So today we are releasing the carbon that was trapped in the Earth all those years ago. A decrease in volcanic activity might have lowered CO2 levels, as less volcanic outgassing meant less atmospheric CO2. This one is fairly straightforward, so let's move on to the next theory. An increase in silicate weathering, another part of the carbon cycle, could also have this effect. During the weathering process, CO2 is converted into bicarbonate, removing it from the atmosphere and dissolving it in seawater. An increase in this complex process would have the net effect of reducing atmospheric CO2. Some researchers have suggested that there was a gamma ray burst. The suddenness of the onset of the glaciation event is unusual and could have been triggered by a gamma ray burst within 2 kiloparsecs of Earth. A kiloparsec, if you are unfamiliar, is over 3,000 light years. This event, if it occurred, would have showered the Earth in nitric acid, spurring massive algae blooms in the oceans and depleting ozone from the atmosphere. The algae would use photosynthesis and so reduce CO2, while ozone is a greenhouse gas like CO2, and so its removal would also contribute to the rapidly cooling climate on Earth. While evidence for this theory is scant, it remains a fascinating possibility. The remaining two theories hinge on the proximity of the Ordovician meteor event to this extinction. The Ordovician meteor event was a dramatic increase in L-chondrite meteorites on Earth during this time. This much is undisputed, but the exact cause of this increase is unclear. The prevailing theory is that there was a collision in the asteroid belt between Mars and Jupiter. Shards from this event would have reached Earth, resulting in the meteors observed in the fossil record. This would have also caused a dust storm, reflecting solar radiation away from Earth and triggering the Hernantian glaciation. A recently discovered impact crater in southeastern Australia may support this theory, though further research is needed. However, a recent study proposes a different explanation. Tomkins et al. 2024 suggests that the main body of an asteroid had a near-miss encounter with Earth. It broke apart near the planet, and its debris were trapped in Earth's gravitational pull, forming a ring around Earth, similar to those seen around Saturn today. This ring would have shaded the Earth, blocking much of the sunlight and triggering the cooling event. In time, these asteroids would have fallen to Earth, providing the observed meteorites. While hard to prove, this theory offers an intriguing alternative perspective. Many of these hypotheses are not mutually exclusive, and it is likely that it was a mixture of these factors or others that caused the sudden onset of the glaciation. We know the meteor event occurred. We know the first terrestrial plants appeared, and many of the other theories could occur alongside these known events. Regardless of the exact cause, there was a glaciation event that triggered the first pulse of the Ordovician-Silurian Extinction Event. This pulse hit deep water or tropical sea organisms particularly hard. One notable loss was Pholiomena, a genus of brachiopods. Their complete extinction at this time, despite the resilience they proved during previous extinctions, suggests a severe impact on these specialized low-oxygen deep-water habitats. While the first pulse was triggered by glaciation, the second pulse occurred at the end of the Hernantian stage and extended into the early Silurian. As abruptly as the glaciation began, it ended, leading to significant warming. This rapid change triggered anoxia and euxinia in the oceans, conditions characterized by a lack of oxygen. The evidence for this can be observed, as the massive anoxia was accompanied by an explosion in black shale distribution. This is a type of rock dense in organic matter, and it spread across the entire ocean floor during the late Ordovician, indicating low oxygen environments. The warming temperatures likely increased nutrient levels in the oceans, causing massive cyanobacteria blooms. Although cyanobacteria photosynthesize and release oxygen, their large numbers can deplete dissolved oxygen in water, a process known as eutrophication. These blooms block sunlight from underwater plants, reducing overall photosynthesis, and consume oxygen at night. Decomposing algal blooms further deplete oxygen, leading to these anoxic conditions. The Ordovician-Silurian extinction event's effects were profound and long-lasting. About 85% of all species were impacted. Specific groups faced severe losses. 70% of trilobite genera went extinct, including the entire order Agnostida. The formerly common order Asafida survived with only one genus. Bryozoans lost over 30% of genera, but most families survived. Echinoderms, particularly crinoids, also faced significant losses. Conodonts and bivalves were heavily impacted, while sponges remained relatively unscathed and massively diversified following the extinction event. Thus ended the Ordovician period, and the Silurian period began. Compared to the tumultuous Cambrian and Ordovician periods, the Silurian was relatively stable. During this period, the ozone layer formed in the atmosphere, protecting Earth from the sun's ultraviolet radiation. This pivotal development made life on land far more viable. Complex terrestrial plants began to appear, along with terrestrial arthropods like centipedes, arachnids, and insects. Coral reefs emerged in the oceans, and vertebrates continued to evolve. The jawless fishes that first appeared in the Ordovician diversified, and the first jawed fishes made their debut. The climate was warm, and there were no major extinction events. Sounds like a peaceful era, right? Well, not so fast. While it was more stable, the Silurian still experienced some notable events. During the Silurian, three extinction events occurred over a span of 12 million years. Though these were nowhere near on the scale of the Ordovician-Silurian extinction event, or any of the Big Five, they are still worth mentioning. The first of these is the Ireviken Event, named after the location where it was most thoroughly studied in Sweden. This event occurred around 432 million years ago, in the middle of the Silurian period, and lasted no longer than 200,000 years. This extinction seemed to originate in the deep seas, hitting deep sea species the hardest, while organisms in shallower waters were barely affected. It caused the extinction of around 80% of all conodont species, 64% of graptolites, and 50% of trilobites. Other groups like bristleworms and brachiopods were also likely impacted, although they are less researched. While the Silurian was the period early land colonizers started evolving, all extinction events in the Silurian, including the Ireviken event, were confined to marine ecosystems. It is possible that some terrestrial species were affected, but the known causes of the extinction events are more targeted at life in the oceans. Additionally, there is no fossil evidence of mass extinctions among the terrestrial taxa, so it is considered unlikely that they were significantly affected by these events. The cause of the Ireviken event is still debated. It was preceded by severe volcanic eruptions, and followed by the Scheinwoodian glaciation. The cooling likely resulted from these eruptions, suggesting the extinctions were due to global temperature changes. However, this doesn't fully explain why deep sea organisms were more severely impacted. The leading theory suggests that as cooling occurred, the seas were also depleted of oxygen, severely affecting deep sea organisms with slower metabolisms and disrupting nutrient availability in the deep ocean. The second minor extinction event is the Mulde Event, which occurred around 427 million years ago, during the Homerian stage. Its primary cause was a significant drop in sea levels, followed by a rapid rise due to melting ice sheets from a warming climate, one of the fastest sea level changes recorded in Earth's history. The Mulde Event was devastating for graptolites, with some estimates suggesting a loss of 95% of their species. Conodont fossils also decreased drastically, but higher sediment rates during this time may have compressed sedimentary layers, indicating that changes to conodont fossils occurred over a longer time span than the fossil record suggests. If true, this suggests that conodonts were not severely impacted by the Mulde Event, but may have been gradually declining throughout this time period due to other factors. The last of these minor extinctions was the Lau Event, occurring 420 million years ago. It significantly affected conodonts, although their numbers gradually recovered afterwards. Graptolites were also impacted, but mainly in the aftermath of the event, due to significant changes in the carbon cycle. The exact cause of these changes remains unclear, with theories including alterations in ocean currents, volcanic activity, or organic carbon burial. These three events, the Ireviken, Mulde, and Lau, may be minor in the grand scheme of life on Earth, but they are important at highlighting the fragility but also the resilience of ecosystems. The organisms affected were some of the earliest to evolve, and while specific lineages were lost, the larger groups not only survived but were able to recover and diversify following the extinction events. These episodes serve as reminders of the dynamic nature of life on our planet, showcasing how life's adaptability and tenacity can lead to incredible evolutionary leaps. Understanding these smaller extinction events helps us appreciate the intricate balance within ecosystems and underscores the importance of biodiversity in fostering resilience against future changes. Unlike previous periods, the Silurian didn't conclude with the dramatic mass extinction. Instead, scientists marked the transition from the Silurian to the Devonian with the appearance of Monograptus uniformis in the fossil record. This species of graptolite is an excellent marker due to its widespread presence, distinctive morphology, and rapid evolution. Its first and last appearances in the fossil record create a clear, discrete span of time. This transition shows that geological periods don't always end with a bang. Unlike the end Ediacaran, Cambrian Ordovician, or Ordovician-Silurian extinction events, the end of the Silurian is marked by the emergence of this new species. I hope you enjoyed this video. In the next installment of our series on mass extinctions, we'll venture into the Devonian period to explore another of the big five extinctions, along with a series of smaller extinction events. I have to admit, this series is turning out to be much longer than I initially anticipated. When I started the first video, I expected it to be only two or three parts. This is the second video, and I've yet to cover half of the events on my list. To be fair, I did spend a considerable portion of this video discussing various theories for the drop in CO2 levels at the end of the Ordovician. But that's the beauty of delving deep into a fascinating subject. You get engrossed and want to learn more. Next week, we'll return to one of my channel's more standard videos with a deep dive into a group of apex predators of the insect world. Thank you for listening, and please share your thoughts on this topic in the comments below.